Now let us see a basic impulse generator circuit.
We already saw a basic circuit, but
now getting a bit into more detail. So what all things will be there? First of all, you need a high voltage source, and from where you will connect it to your source capacitor. Okay, so this is your source capacitor CS, and this is your charging resistance RCS, and this is where you will be applying your high voltage DC, because you have to get a higher voltage here, so you will be applying a high voltage DC here. This is charging capacitor, this is the source capacitance. Now afterwards, you have your discharge capacitor as well as your the capacitor, the resistance for charging it. Okay, so let us see. First, I am connecting a resistor here. Then you have your capacitor, which is what, this is the load capacitor CB, and in, then you can apply what, you can apply your resistor for discharge. R is the resistor for discharge, and this one here RD, this is the resistor through which your power is transferred to CB, and this I have a particular name, let us note it down. RCH is what, that is the charging capacitor, means that is which is charging your source capacitor. Okay, so charging resistance. Okay, this is the charging resistance, which will, what is its purpose? It is for, means we will apply high voltage, and through this charging resistor your capacitor CS means that is what, the source capacitor, or it is also called as the stage capacitor. Okay, that is this is getting charged, so that is the source or the stage capacitor. Then you have RD is known as the damping resistor. RD is the damping resistor. Okay, yes, there was a power cut. So that is RD is damping resistor. Then we have your our RE. RE means that RE is the discharge resistor, right? RE is quite clear to you that that is the path through your CS as well as CD is going to discharge. So RE is the discharge resistor, and as I already told you, CB is what, CB is the load capacitor. CD is the load capacitor. Okay. So with the names itself, it is quite clear that what all these components are doing, except this RD. Okay, RD is called as damping resistor, and why it is so, we will discuss later. Okay. So this is how your say basic impulse generator circuit will look like, and this kind of a circuit, this is called as the circuit with the load and connection. This is called as circuit with load and connection. Load and connection of what? The circuit with load and connection of your discharge capacitor. So this RE, we can either place nearer to the load, or we can place nearer to the source. So a connection where your RE is nearer to the load is called as what? That is called as then we say that what, RE is nearer to the load. Okay. Or we can say that it's a source and connection whenever if I change the circuit like this, this is RCS and this is CS, and afterwards instead of this RD here, I am going to one more missing part here is the switch. Okay, you have a switch here like this, so that we should have a switching operation. So if I am placing it the other way around, like RE is nearby here, my R is nearby here, and what, then you have your RD as shown here. Then what will happen? Then such a connection, when your RE is nearby source, that is a source connection of your discharge capacitor. So these two ways are there. Right. Now let us get into the working. Okay. I think the circuit is quite clearer to you. Now we will get into the working of this. Okay. So there are two things, possible things here. One, the first process is that using your RCS, what, your source capacitance CS, that is getting completely charged. So that is our first part, completely charged, and that already, let us assume that already happened. Your source capacitance CS is completely charged. Once it happened, what will happen? Then you have the charging of, then you can say you are going to have the charging of what? Charging of your load capacitance C. So let us see how it is going to happen. So if you remember, you have your capacitance here, right? your CS is already there and it is completely charged. And whenever it is charging, then what is important? You have your RD only.
Right.
RL is not important. Then you have your RD and here you have your CD. Right. The load capacitance. This is RD and this is your CD. So this is the connection whenever you are charged, whenever a transfer of power is happening between what? The CS to CD. So current will flow like this and you will have the charging of your capacitance CD. Right. So this is the charging part. And interestingly, what will be the time constant here? As you can see here, your CS and CB are in series in the circuit. Right. CS and CB are series. So what will be the equivalent capacitance? The C equivalent will be equal to CS into CB divided by CS plus CB. I think you are aware of this. Whenever your capacitances are in series, then it is quite the reverse of the resistances in what I can say series. So it is equivalent to the way the resistances are in parallel. So C equal to CS into CB by CS plus CB. Right. And what will be my time constant? For an RC circuit like this, the time constant, let me call it as tau 1, that will be equal to what? RD is already there, RD into C equivalent. Right. So when I say RD into C equivalent, it is equal to what? RD into CSCV divided by CS plus CV. Right. Now, whenever we are making a circuit like this, one more thing we keep in mind, that we will keep RD to be less than or equal to at least 0.1 times RE. Means the value of RD will be less than or equal to 0.1 times the discharge capacitor, discharge resistance, and similarly, your CS value, your CB value will be less than or equal to what? 0.1 times CS. So these two things you will keep in mind, and because of that, this time constant tau will be, as you can see, capacitance are parallel here, and this part that will be less than whichever be the least one among them, and RD is already what? Quite lesser only. So because of that, your time constant tau 1, your time constant tau 1 is going to be very lesser. Right, so your time constant tau 1 is going to be very lesser, and when I said charging, that is the place in your impulse voltage, the peak value or the initial part is caused due to this charging of the load capacitor. Understood? And that time constant should be quite smaller only, because it will take very lesser time to rise into its peak value. Understood? So in this process, you are in the impulse voltage form, you are creating the first initial part of the wave. Now you have to create what? You have to create the end part of it. Understood? So your time constant is what here? Your important part is this time constant. It is equal to what? RD equal to tau 1 equal to RD into CS CB divided by CS plus CB. I think it is clear to you. Now what will happen? So your CB will get charged. Your CB will get charged, and that is what is the initial part of the wave up to what? Up to a maximum voltage VP, means the peak value. Once your peak value is achieved, afterwards what will happen? Afterwards, both the CS and CB will get discharged through your RL. Okay, let us draw that circuit also. Now, so that is the first step, what? Charging, through which you got your initial part of the wave. Now, our second, next part is what? Next part is understanding. Understanding your discharging part. Understood? So let us see the next part. Means what? Discharging through CS as well as CB. So how that circuit will be? As you remember, you can rewind and see. As you remember, the circuit will look like this. You have your CS here, right? And what? You have your CB also, but through what? Through your RD, you have your CB also. That is CS, this is CB, and this is what? This is your RD. And now here you have your RE. Right. So RD, RE, and CS and CB. So this is your circuit when it is discharging, right? Your CS will discharge through like this, and your CB also will discharge through this. And as I already mentioned, your value of RD is less than or equal to what? 0.1 times RE. So RE is 10 times larger, RE is the higher, have the higher part here. So what will happen? Whatever be the charge getting transferred, the most of the potential is getting dropped in what? In this RE only, right? So most of the energy is what along this RE. That is why we can approximate the circuit into something like this. So if we approximate it, so after approximation, what you will have? So if we approximate it, if we approximate the circuit, we can draw the circuit as CS like this. Then RD and RE we can draw in series. As I said, RD is comparatively smaller compared to the discharge capacitor RE. Then your CB here. Okay, so that we can write the equation quite easily. Even if you write for this equivalent circuit also, you will come around with a similar value of time constant. So what will be the time constant for this circuit? If I write tau 2, it is quite clear here. What is the time constant? Time constant is anyhow going to be RC only. So here, capacitance CS and CB are in parallel, right? So capacitance CS and CB are in parallel. That is why and capacitor RD and RE are in series. So equivalent resistance will be RD plus RE. Right. RC is a time constant and equivalent capacitance will be what? Since they are in parallel, it will be CS plus CB. So your time constant tau 2 is RD plus RE into CS plus CB. Right. And right now, if you remember the time constant tau 1, what was the time constant tau 1? Your time constant tau 1 was what? RD into CS CB divided by CS plus CB. So if you compare this, you can easily understand. RE is already what? 10 times RD. So you are having a higher value here. And CS plus CB is what? Again summation here. So your time constant tau 2 will be comparatively higher than what? The time constant tau 1. And that, and here already discharge is happening. That is why the first part is already made in the charging process. And what? The second part, discharge is happening in the second part. And here you have a larger time constant. So you are able to control the time constant in charging as well as discharging using these two resistances and adjusting their value. Again, I am saying the important factor here is how you have decided your RD, RE and CS and CB values. Your RD value will be what? Less than or equal to 0.1 times RE. So that makes the difference here. I think it is clear to you. Okay. Now, we will see that its Laplace transform in order to understand the waveform to a better extent. Now, let us conduct circuit analysis on this problem. For that, I am going to use a transform circuit, or I am going to convert it into Laplace transform. So, first of all, what was our circuit? Our circuit was something like this. You have your source capacitor like this, and you have a switch. You got your resistance RD, and you have your RE. RD is your this charging capacitor, whichever your CB is getting charged, then RE is the discharge capacitor, discharge resistance. So this is CS, this is CB, this is RE, and this is RD. You have your switch, right? So this was your circuit, and as I said already, you apply a high voltage to your source capacitor, and you already charged it to a voltage of, let us say, V0. Okay. You have already charged your capacitor CS to a voltage of what? V0. Right. You already applied a V0, a constant DC voltage. Right. So you can apply it as in terms of a step signal, you can say it is V0 U of T. Such a signal you are applying here. And your output, as you can say, it is across the load capacitance. So this is your output. Okay. And let me mark it as V of T. Right. So both charging as well as discharging will be reflected in your output voltage, which is V of T. So that is our circuit. So you are already familiar with how we can transform a circuit. So I am just drawing the same here. So if we transform a circuit from here, as I already said, you have a potential across this thing, which is V0. So, a capacitor here with a potential across it. So, we will show that potential as what? Another source. Right. And in Laplace transform, since it is a step signal, we can write it as V0 by S. So, that is our input signal. And afterwards, then what you have, you have your capacitance. So, capacitance is shown here. Then you have your resistance. Right, then you have your parallel resistance also, RE as shown here. Then your capacitance like this, right, CB like this, right. So here, whatever be the voltage, this is already written. So this is V0 by S, and your output voltage is now what in Laplace domain it will be given by V of S. V of t will become V of S, right? This is your CB before, but in Laplace transform, in the transform circuit, what the capacitance will be? That will be 1 by SCB, right? CB will become 1 by SCB. This will become 1 by SCS. This is your RD and this is your R, right? So this is how you transform the circuit from your normal time domain circuit to your Laplace transform. So now let us write the equation here for what? For the VOS means what? Your output voltage in Laplace transform. Now let us write the equation. So I need only the circuit in what? In Laplace transform, right? The transform circuit. So what will be the equation for VOS? As you are seeing here, you apply a voltage of V0 by S here, like this, right? You applied a voltage of V0 by S here, and you have an output of what? V of S. So V of S is getting divided between what? That is the potential across this RE and capacitance branch, right? This parallel branch, whatever the potential coming, that is your output potential or V of S. So I can write V of S as, this V0 by S, which is my input, into Z2 divided by Z1 plus Z2. Okay. Now, what is Z2? Z2 means this branch wherever you are having your output potential. What is that branch Z2? I can write Z2 is equal to what? This RE and SCB in parallel. 1 by SCB in parallel. Right. So, what will happen? RE and 1 by SCB in parallel means Z2 is RE into 1 by SCB divided by RE plus 1 by SCB. So that is my Z2, means impedance 2, okay, of the circuit. This is just what, this is the potential of the voltage division formula. Z2 is Z2 plus Z1 plus Z2. What is Z1 here? Z1 is this branch, right? Z1 is this branch, RD and the capacitance involved CD. So there your Z1 will be equal to RD plus 1 by SCS. So you already know Z1 and Z2. And now if you apply this equation here and you have got an S here, so what it will be, it become, you will have an equation of V of S, right? In terms of V0 by S and value. And as you can see here in this circuit, you have capacitance as well as what? Resistances, right? You have two capacitors like this and this, you have two resistances. So that is why your circuit, this equation, when you write, you will get an equation in this form. Let us see. You can write by yourself. Okay, you can solve this equation. Everything is given. We have already written V of S equation, and now if you substitute this Z1 and Z2 values, you will come up with an equation like this. V of S equal to V0 divided by K into 1 by S square plus AS plus B. So this you will come up with a equation similar to this. Okay, so that you can derive by yourself. So in that case, the values for A, B and K you will get as A will be equal to, okay, this you can derive by yourself, that is that you can do afterwards. A will be equal to 1 by RD CS plus 1 by RD CB plus 1 by RECP. So that will be A, and B will be equal to, okay, this will be A, and B will be equal to, B is the last term, so that will be equal to 1 by RD RP CSCP. So this is A, this is B, and K will be equal to RD into CP. Okay. So this is, yeah, okay, this is true. K will be equal to RDCB. So this I am not going to derive here. You can see for yourself by just substituting the values of Z1 and Z2. Z1 means what? Z1 is RD and 1 by CS in series. Z2 is what? 1 by SCB and RE in parallel. If you substitute that in the equation for V of S, you will come up with this equation where K is given by RDCB, A is given by 1 by RDCS plus 1 by RDCB plus 1 by RECB, and B equal to 1 by RD RECSCB. Right. So that is what you are going to come up with once you solve this equation. Okay. Now let us take what? Now let us take the inverse Laplace transform. Okay, now let us take the inverse Laplace transform so that we will get v of t. So what we will apply here, once you have an equation like this, s square plus ax plus b, you can write this thing as what? You can write this thing, v of s equal to v0 divided by k. That's a constant. Okay, we are not, we don't have to think about that. And then what? Then some value, then this is s square plus as plus p, right? So we have to, we will split this equation into what? S plus k1 into s plus k2, right? And here, so this way you have to split this equation, right? S plus k1 into s plus k2. Then what? Then you will write it as what? This v0 by k is again constant. Then you will write it as what? As an addition of these two ones, right? This is similar to s plus k2. So how we will find out this one? If you have to get for what will be the numerator for s plus k1? I think you already performed this in network theory or in control system and all. So if you take here, you will get it as 1 by k2 minus k1, and here you will get it as what? Minus 1 by k2 minus k1. Okay, so I'm not elaborating on that. So you will get this way. This is how you are going to what find out your equation, right? So with this, if we write our inverse Laplace transform, what is the equation for 1 by s in the form 1 by s plus k? It is e power minus kt, right? So similarly, if we write it here, our v of t will be what? V0 by k is a constant, so I am taking it as it is. Then this 1 by k2 minus k1 is common in both the equations, so I can write it as 1 by k2 minus k1, right? 1 by k2 minus k1 into what? Into e raised to minus k1t minus e raised to minus k2t, right? So this will be my equation. This will be my equation in time domain. What? V0 by k into 1 by k2 minus k1. So this much is a constant. V0 by k into 1 by k2 minus k1 is a constant. Then it is what? Then it is a superposition of two exponentially decaying functions. One is what? E raised to minus k1t, and another one is e raised to minus k2t, but with an opposite polarity. Are you getting my point? So now our signal, our impulse signal is what? It is a summation of two exponentially decaying signals. One is what? Exponentially decaying with a positive polarity. Another one is the exponentially decaying with a negative polarity. Right. So that is the main point here. What? Our impulse voltage is a function of what? Function of superposition of what? Superposition of two exponentially decaying functions. Superposition of e raised to minus k1t and what? Minus e raised to minus k2t. One with a positive polarity, another with a negative polarity. It is a summation of both. Okay. So that is our understanding. And one more thing here is this what? This k1, k2. Okay. K1, k2 is, as we already discussed, the denominator what's what? S square plus as plus b. So if we have to get roots of this equation, how we can write it? K1, comma k2 will be equal to a by 2 minus or plus root of what? A by 2 all square minus b. Right. So this equation is familiar to you for an equation in the form what? X square plus ax plus b or x square plus as plus b. So from here, by knowing the values of a, b as well as k, we can solve this equation. And a, b and k, what? We already have defined those equations in terms of the resistance and capacitance values in the circuit, right? So that is how we usually design an impulse signal. And now let us see graphically how the superposition of these two exponentially decaying signals will make what? Our impulse signal. Okay, so let us see graphically. This is my y-axis and this is my x-axis. Okay. So this is time and this is my magnitude, or what? This is the v of t. So as I said earlier, first let us take the first equation, what? V0 by k into 1 by k2 minus k1 into e raised to minus k1t, right? So it's an exponentially decaying function. And here, if you see from the equation, you will understand that your k1 will be what? Your k1 and k2, if you consider, k1 will be greater than k2. So, this k2 will be greater than k1. So, with that understanding, if you see, whenever I say k, what k 2 is greater than k1, then what it means, 1 by k2 will be lesser than 1 by k1. Okay. So I think if you compare this equation with what, e raised to minus t by tau, this tau represents the time constant or how much faster it is decaying. So when here what, since your k1 is lesser, then what, the time constant for k1 will be higher compared to what, the k2 part. So the first term here was e raised to minus k1t. So since your k1 is lesser here, the time constant will be higher. So because of that, let me draw this part here. If at a time t equal to 0, what will be e raised to minus k1t will be equal to 1 only. So what, the equation will give you the constant part. V0 here, then you will have V0 by k into 1 by k2 minus k1. So this will be your constant magnitude here. Then you will have an exponentially decaying curve with minus 1 by k1 as the time constant. So let us mark that curve as something like this. Okay. So let us mark this curve as what, your exponentially decaying curve like this. And compared to this k1, since k1 is lesser and k2 is higher, your next curve, e raised to minus k2t, that will be what? That will be more steeper because there your time constant is comparatively lesser, right? So 1 by k2 will be lesser than 1 by k1 means what? Your, this is correspond to what? Tau 2, right? So your tau 2 will be what? Lesser than tau 1. So for this curve, it will be what? Comparatively more steeper. But that also, what is the second curve? That is minus e into k minus k2t, right? So in that case, that e minus e into minus k2t means what? E raised minus k2t is a decaying curve. When you have opposite polarity, it will come to the negative axis. And this also will start at what? Minus V0 by k into 1 by k2 minus k1. Right, with the negative polarity. Then, but since the time constant is somewhat smaller, you will have a curve something like this. You will have a curve like this. So ultimately, it will be the summation of both of these curves. And time t equal to 0, since for the first curve you have V0 by k into 1 by k2 minus k1, and for the second part what you have are minus V0 by k into 1 by k2 minus k1. So if you take the sum of it, at time t equal to 0, your superposed wave means the total V of t will be what? It will start at the here. Okay, then afterwards if you see, you will get a erase to my minus e t k2 t. So afterwards you will see what? You will see a curve like this. Okay. And it will be exponentially decaying afterwards. It will when the peak will occur, depend on what, the time constant value. Since the second curve is having a lesser time constant, the first one is what, having a higher time constant, your ultimate V of t will look like this. Okay. So that is how it graphically represents. This is what, this is your first curve, means what, V0 by k into 1 by k2 minus k1 into e raised to minus k1t. And this is your second curve, which is what, V0 by k into 1 by k2 minus k1 into e raised to minus k2t, but what, with a negative here. So that is where the polarity gets to this. And when you sum it up, you will have an inverse waveform of this shape in whichever way we want. So this is how we generate an inverse voltage, and the what, the time constant we are able to control by varying the parameters in the inverse circuit. Clear? So in a normal waveform, in testing and all, we need two types of impulse voltages, as we already discussed. One is what, the lightning impulse, and another one is the switching impulse. So depending on that, we will determine, we will take what, the value of 1 by k1 and 1 by k2, or the k1 k2 value we will decide based on that. Okay, so those values work, like if you need what, that is allocated based on what, the time constant. For a lightning impulse, we are looking for 1.2 bar 50 microsecond signal, and for a switching impulse, we are looking for what, 250 bar 2500 microsecond. Okay. In the notes given to you, I have given the value of k1 and k2. If you observe that, you will see that way we can vary, right? For based on whatever we need. If it's for a lightning impulse, we will adjust the value of RD, CE and CB in order to get whatever rise time and rise time and tail time we need. Similarly, for a switching impulse voltage of what, 250 by 2500 microsecond, again we will change based on the values of RD, RE and CE. Correct. Now let us see. a bit more. As we already discussed, I already told you in the circuit that what is the significance of this RD? What is the significance of this RD? Right, I already told you that
it is named that damping resistor. Why it is called as damping resistor? It is quite simple to understand. Why it is called damping resistor? When in our circuit we always mark what? We only mark CS, CB, RD as well as RE only, right? So in reality we are connecting all these capacitance and resistances, or even the resistance also. These are also having inductance also. If you are having a wire, then definitely there is an associated inductance with this. So we cannot say that there is no inductance at all. Right, so the whole inductance distributed over what, over the capacitance plates or over the your resistances or the connecting wires, whatever it is, that inductance we have to represent in a lambda form, right? And if you see the charging circuit, charging of the load capacitor circuit, you have what normally we represent a CS, right? And you have a RD also, that right? Then what? Then you represent in parallel a capacitance CB. So this is our normal circuit, RD, and you have a CB. And in series with that, you have to represent an inductance L here. Why? Because this is the length parameter which we represent for the whole inductance of the circuit, right? Under that condition, this is an RLC circuit, right? And in an RLC circuit, you can have, this is an RLC circuit and a second order system. So you can have what? You can have the circuit to get oscillatory also, depending on the value of L, C and R, right? I think you are aware of that. You have learned that in control systems. So depending on that, if you remember, in a second order system, there is something called what, critical resistance and all. And for the system to be non-oscillatory, the condition is that RB should be greater than or equal to what? 2 times root of L by C. I think you remember this. RB should be greater than or equal to 2 times root of L by C. So this is what, if RD equal to this one, that we call as what, the critical resistance. So we should make sure that your value of the damping resistor should be what, greater than or equal to 2 root L by C, so that you have a damped oscillation. Understood? So that you have a damped oscillation and you have a proper inverse signal. Otherwise, your system will what, become oscillatory, right? If this condition is not met, then your system will become oscillatory, and that is why your resistance RD is called as damping resistor, because it is kept for the purpose of damping also. We have to make sure that this condition is met for a particular circuit. Now you can ask me what will happen when you are discharging it. Why we will not have a oscillatory response in discharge? As we already mentioned, RE is what? RD, I have given this condition that RD is what? Less than or equal to 0.1 times RE, or RE is already what? 10 times greater than RD, right? So anyhow, in your circuit, RD should be greater to meet what, for the same inductance and capacitance, RD should be greater than critical resistance, right? So since already in the design we are making sure that you are RE is definitely greater than RD by 10 times, so it will always what, your RE value will be definitely greater than what, R critical. That condition is already met. So that we are not specifying, or we need not bother about a discharge circuit. We only have to bother about what, the charging circuit. And that is why, that is the significance of this RD in the design. Okay. So in the next class, we will see multi-stage impulse generators in detail. Thank you.